coming up on Need to Know Rochester. The Supreme Court ruled on affirmative action, but how does the move impact area colleges and universities? We'll discuss the court's decision and what it could mean for the future of affirmative action. Also on the show, it's an unpaid job often meant to help you get your foot in the door. I'm talking about the unpaid internship. College students, get ready. Changes are on the way. And a look at the game of chess. It's still alive and thriving among Rochester area kids. Those stories coming up right now on Need to Know Rochester.
Rochester's news magazine since 1997. This is Need to Know Rochester.
Hello, I'm Helene Bian-Duty-Hofer, and thank you for joining me for this edition of Need to Know Rochester on our new day and time. Well, affirmative action was one of the more closely watched rulings from the Supreme Court last month. The specific case on the table was Fisher versus the University of Texas. And here's a brief synopsis of that case. It involves a Texas woman, Abigail Fisher, who argued she was denied admission at the University of Texas at Austin because she's white. That school uses race as a factor in admissions. But Fisher claimed her application was rejected, even though, according to her, she was more qualified than some minority applicants. So how did the court rule? It sent the case back down to the lower courts. The decision was basically a reprieve for affirmative action in public colleges and universities. So how does this impact schools in the greater Rochester area? And what's at stake in the big picture? In the studio to tackle those questions is William Clark, president of the Urban League of Rochester, and Randall Langston, vice president of enrollment management at the college at Brockport. And thank you both for joining me today.
Thank you for having us.
And just to start off, before we dig into the details of the ruling and what it could mean, William, what do you see as the goal of affirmative action, and does the Urban League of Rochester support that goal in 2013?
Absolutely. The goal of affirmative action is really to level the playing field, and the playing field has not been leveled yet. Each year, our national office, along with 100 Urban League affiliates, put out a report called The State of Black America. We look at how African Americans relate to whites as it relates to health, as it relates to wealth, as it relates to income, as it relates to employment. And I will tell you, over the last 20 years, the bar has not moved. We're still coming up at about 0.7% in all areas as it relates to whites in this community.
Well, I'm not sure if the outcome of this landing was that landmark, you know, ruling that people were hoping for. I mean, no new law was made. Right. The Supreme Court did not end affirmative actions in the college admissions process. And I think depending on how this goes, it could go either way. And I think some people for affirmative action may say, hey, this was a win for us. Some against it may say, this might be a win for us. So I think one thing to point out, though, when it comes to Rochester area colleges and universities, race is not a factor in the admissions process for most. And Randall, the college at Brockport, it's a state school. It's under the SUNY umbrella. But the state doesn't ban affirmative action in the admissions process like some states do. So why not use race as a factor if it has the potential to create a more diverse student body?
Sure. We've also been monitoring the Supreme Court case, and we feel obviously very strongly that a diverse class and a diverse population of the school is critically important to not only the mission of the institution, but also the state of New York as well. So as we look at admissions and enrollment, some of the things that we try to focus on, obviously we look at the student's academic caliber, the preparation for the student to come into the college. So we tend to look at those variables, but also what we do is we take an approach that's a dual approach, not only just for the admission side, but many of our own admission advisors and counselors are out traveling, meeting with community leaders. We do we visit inner cities across the state of New York. We also actively engage individuals both internally and externally to help assist us in terms of our mentioning about the college, talking about all the exciting things that we have to offer at our school. So we do a lot of different things. We also are heavily invested in New York City. We have two advisors down there right now that are working in different areas of the city to bring a diverse population up to our school.
How difficult is it to do that?
Yeah, it's you know what, it's a 12-month-a-year job, and it involves really working very, very hard with all of our partners, developing relationships, working with families. We talk about when we're recruiting students, we're not just recruiting students, we're recruiting the entire family. So we work directly with family members. We spend countless hours with families trying to help them understand the admissions process, help them understand the financial aid process. Many of these students, we have many of our students who are our Pell recipients. We also have many of our students who are first generation coming in. So we feel as a public university for access, I think it's very important to be able to engage them and help them understand the process for their success at our school.
And let me ask this. You know, when I was in high school, this is Columbus, Ohio, I can remember when my guidance counselor, you know, would call me in her office, and my peers who look like me, minority students in my class, and she would say, hey, a college is coming. They're about 2-3 hours away. They're coming to visit. I know you're considering this school, this school, and this school, but give this school a chance because they are really trying to recruit minority students. And then I hear, I'm like, okay, you know, what college is it? And I hear the name, and I'm thinking, there's no way, because I know that that campus isn't diverse. I know there aren't people that look like me, and I want that type of camaraderie. I want to have that when I go to school. And William, why do you think it is so hard? I mean, is it that mentality? Is that one of the factors that makes it difficult, like Randall was saying, to recruit students of different racial backgrounds?
I think the colleges that do a great effort are able to create that diversity, and the colleges that don't extend themselves to those schools where we have a concentration of minority students, they're not going to get the diverse population on their campuses. And I wanted to just take a step back to the decision. We view that as a temporary reprieve. We don't view it as a victory because we know that it's been put back into the appellate court and that a decision needs to be made there. But when you really look at this decision and you look at what Abigail Fisher is saying, she is saying that she gets a better high school education, better than the top 10% of these students that are going to diverse schools. So I think it speaks to our education system, and what we need to do is we need to build more equality in the system to make sure, because if education was the same across every district and every school, this would be a non-issue.
Let me ask you both, do we still need affirmative action? I mean, people will say, they'll argue, hey, it's 2013, we have a biracial president, he's in his second term, and that alone is proof that we are making progress. What do you think?
I would say, when you look at the most recent presidential election, you had 34 states attempt to toughen their voting right laws. For example, Texas indicated that a college ID no longer qualified for voting, but a gun permit did. So you have governors of states that indicated that the Democrats would not carry their states because they're requiring state IDs that they knew they could not administer in time for the election. So I think the fact that 34 states attempted to strengthen their voting rights lets you know that there is an undercurrent and there is still a need for affirmative action in this country.
I'll agree with William. I think that we definitely need to continue to work hard and strive for racial equality throughout the country. We look at our admission numbers at Brockport. Right now, our college is our entire college population is about 16% minority. We've made some significant strides. We're seeing increases. For example, our transfer students that were coming in this past year, 20% of the population of transfer students, new students coming in, are now minority. 17% are minority for freshman students coming in, but that also says that we're only at 20%, only at 16%. We have a long way to still go here. So I agree with my colleague here that we still have ways to go. And I think that we talk about access as someone who works at a public institution, access is important, and it's critically important to continue these steps going forward.
Well, thank you both for joining me for this discussion. Randall Langston, Vice President of Enrollment Management at the College at Brockport, and William Clark, President of the Urban League of Rochester. Thank you again, and for continuing coverage of the affirmative action debate, tune in to WXXINews.org. It can be the ticket to a full-time job. Well, that's the hope, at least for some college students. It's the internship. Many of us have had one or a handful of these jobs that either steer us on the right career path or show us when certain job fields might not be such a good match. But a recent federal court ruling in New York could change the climate for internships, in particular for those that are unpaid. The ruling says that a legal unpaid internship position is one that's solely educational and doesn't benefit the employer. So, is the unpaid intern about to be a thing of the past? Joining us now to discuss the issue more is Burt Nadler, director of the College Career Center at the University of Rochester, and Madeline Britt, a student at RIT who has had a number of internships, both paid and unpaid. So thank you both for joining me.
Thank you.
To provide a little background, the case that really sparked this debate is Glatt versus Fox Searchlight Pictures. And Eric Glatt, a law student, sued Fox, and he claimed that he and other interns, they were working on this film, they were doing the work of paid employees, but they did not get paid. And there are about a million unpaid internships across the United States. And I want to start by asking, is there a case for the unpaid internship? I mean, is this free labor that's become normalized and companies are taking it, for-profit companies rather, are taking advantage of student work? Or does this really provide that genuine foot-in-the-door educational experience?
Well, for me, clearly it's not about exploitation. It is about education. And internships today are imperative. 20 years ago, perhaps not. 10 years ago, maybe. Today, they are imperative. So these educational experiences that not only allow people to test fields, but build skills that will allow them to become better candidates for paying jobs down the road are essential.
I definitely agree. And my experience as a, you know, a young person who was an intern was that by those internships, I've had the experiences that I really wouldn't be able to get before them. So I was able to get contacts that I really didn't have before. And it really was an educational experience that was essential to my educational career. So
Eric Glatt, the plaintiff in the case, said that the unpaid internship has become this phenomenon. He says it's spiraled out of control, and he thinks it's more damaging for young people to think that not getting paid is normal and acceptable. And Madeline, given that you've had an opportunity to do the paid and unpaid internship, you know, knowing this court ruling, are you worried at all about the potential, you know, loss of these unpaid gigs that are beneficial for students like you?
I definitely am, and especially because I am a younger student, I'm entering my sophomore year, I'm really not able to get the higher, you know, jobs that I would have been able to get but if I didn't have an internship. So if they were to go away, then the contacts would go away, my resume building skills would go away, and I know a lot of my journalism friends need those internships to survive. So
I had an opportunity to talk with one of the attorneys on the Glatt case earlier this week, Sally Abrahamson. We had a Skype interview, and I asked her about the judge's ruling and the potential implications, given what you just said. I said, you know, these internships can be meat on a resume. Right. This is what helps to get that full-time job. And we'll take a look at our conversation right here. Some local unpaid interns that we talked to said, you know, I'm doing unpaid work, but I'm getting really great experience. It's something that I can add to my resume. So to me, it's worth it. And I'm interested to get your take on that.
Well, there are a couple takes on that. One, a lot of entry-level jobs, you learn a lot at. That's not the test that is applied. The test is really applied is about what the employer set up. Did the employer set up an educational program? And one of the things the judge said is that if you went off of how much people learned, it would become very subjective and a totally unmanageable test. For instance, if I, you know, didn't think I was learning a lot at my job, but my coworker thought she was learning a lot, then does one of us get paid and the other not? He said you just can't have that kind of subjective test. The second thing is the Fair Labor Standards Act was set up as a right that you can't waive. So in this country, you can't waive your right to the minimum wage in the same way you can't waive your right to be paid. And part of the reason is because between workers and corporations have a lot more power. And the lawmakers back in the 1930s were worried that workers would be strong-armed into doing work for free because they were looking for employment, which is a lot of the reason people take unpaid internships is kind of as a foot in the door. And so it's protective.
It seems that this is the classic case of unintended consequences. I mean, so that students can make a few dollars, there is the potential for companies to decrease or eliminate internships and for colleges to struggle to find enough paid internships for their students. I mean, who wins?
I think it's not a matter of who wins, and I think you're clarifying that there are some issues that are legal in nature, and let's see where those legal rulings take its course. But we in the college environment will always do whatever we can to teach students how to find their own experiential educational opportunities, whether we call them internships, whether we call them projects, whether we call them as legal interns, call them pro bono work. It just doesn't matter. It is a critically now important part of the educational process, whether one has a co-op program like RIT or whether we at the University of Rochester just recognize that internships are imperative, and 93% of all of our seniors, when we poll them, have done at least one internship. 75% have done two or more throughout their academic experiences. So we know they're essential. We will adapt. We will adjust. We wish that these rulings don't lead to the consequences of less paid or unpaid internships, but we'll adapt.
One thing I asked Sally about was quality of work with an unpaid internship, and I want to take a look at this, and you can hear my question to her. On the flip side of the issue, some may argue that the quality of work people are doing at an unpaid internship isn't the best. I mean, if there's a project a company is willing to give someone to work on and they're not paying them for it, then how good can that experience really be?
Well, one thing that the judge said here was that if someone does work, however menial, but work that is productive for the company, they need to be paid for that. And so the Fair Labor Standards Act does not revolve around the quality of someone's work or how low level the work is for the company. The standard really is are these interns engaging in work? And if they are not participating in a training program that is akin to an educational experience or a vocational training program, then they need to be paid for that work, however menial.
Madeline, you've had, again, the chance to work in paid and unpaid jobs. Did you notice a difference in the quality of the work that you were doing, the experience compared, you know, when comparing the two? Was there a difference?
I found that both experiences were very rewarding because I was firm with my employer beforehand and said, what am I going to be getting from this experience? So I did find that both of them were rewarding in itself. But I think, too, that you have to say to the person that you're interning from, how is this benefiting me? How am I being educated? And what is this really doing for my resume? And if those answers really aren't clear, then you should really move on. So I tried to do that. So.
Is this something that comes up with students?
This is something that must come up each and every time, and that is the responsibility of a career services professional, whether the internship is paid or unpaid, if it's for credit or not for credit. If it's for credit, then there are mechanisms by which we will teach students, where we will have a relationship with the employer, and we will make sure that the outcomes, the goals, the outcomes for that experience are, of course, in favor of the student and, as the ruling states, will be educational. The fact that there can be no benefit to the employer is a bit confusing for us because, of course, they're getting a wonderful, hardworking individual. And I think it's important to recognize that the presence or absence of salary, at least I found over the last three decades, do not indicate the quality of the experience for students.
Well, a lot to talk about, and I want to thank you both for being here. RIT student Madeline Britt and Bert Nadler, director of the College Career Center at the University of Rochester, thank you for talking with me today. And to learn more about the future of the unpaid internship, go to our website, wxxinews.org and innovationtrail.org. Believe it or not, but in the midst of Xbox and all the other video game consoles for kids today, there's one game that seems to be standing the test of time. Chess is not only still around, but the game has a number of faithful players in the Rochester area, especially among the younger generation. From interscholastic chess leagues to school tournaments, chess is alive and well. I recently stopped by the Rochester Chess Center and met some kids who told me why they think chess is the best game around.
It helps me do stuff in school. Math problems, it helps me think. It helps me think because if I'm forced to think a lot, it keeps my brain in practice.
Do you take me the bishop?
What are the
forces? I take your bishop.
I like how about all the strategy that's in it, and I like thinking about it, about what the move could be next.
Logan?
Push the e4 pawn up.
Ooh, awesome.
There's a lot of different kinds of chess. Bug house is my favorite kind.
What's that?
It's where you have a clock. You set up for 5 minutes, and then if your time runs out, you lose, or you can checkmate the other person.
He's gonna get a queen.
It forces you to think and you really have to check everything before making a move.
Good game.
I need the second.
In the studio now to talk about the longevity of chess and what makes the game so popular among some kids is Ron Lorman, owner of the Rochester Chess Center, and James Hiltunen, a chess instructor who started playing at the Rochester Chess Center in elementary school. Thank you both for joining me today. So what is it about the game of chess that's different from other board games? Why the popularity in 2013?
Wow. There are so many brain dead type games around, and when kids discover chess, they realize there's a lot more to it, and it doesn't take a lot. They can sometimes beat adults at it, and there's very few games like that around where you can beat adults, so that keeps their interest going probably.
And what do you think, James? You've been playing for a long time. You started the Chess Center when you were young. You're still young.
Thanks.
You're welcome. What is it that you think, why do you think kids are still intrigued by the game?
What I've experienced when I was a chess instructor and when I was a kid playing too is that there's a certain part of chess that like makes you amazed, like how you can create a puzzle throughout the game, and there's a never-ending possibilities that's always occurring in chess. No game is going to be replayed, which is awesome. And I think that kids, when I get to teach them, often their face lights up when they get to make like an amazing move that they, oh my God, it just clicks. And that's really great.
Well, one thing I noticed when I was at the Chess Center, kids told me what they love about the game is strategy. I mean, we saw it in the video. And I would bet that parents would prefer to see their kids playing chess as opposed to video games, but both require strategy. So I'm curious to know, is there a difference between the two? Is there something you can gain from strategy from the game of chess that maybe you can't gain from a video game?
Well, you need to prioritize and evaluate, and it isn't just react. Video games are probably mostly reaction and not a lot of long-term planning. And chess punishes impulsiveness, so that's a good life lesson to be learned from that.
Well, one of the things you mentioned, and I'm trying to figure this out. How is it that you can work all your life to become increasingly better at the game of chess, but a youngster can pick up the game like that and beat an adult at the game? I don't get it.
It's a lot like learning a language. A 2 or 3 year old can learn a language just by observing. Whereas if you or I tried to learn a language, it's very difficult. We have lawns to mow, kids to, you know, paychecks to earn and things like that. They have open minds, and it's really unfair that they have that advantage so early.
Yeah.
Well, you're both very ingrained in the Rochester chess scene. And James, I know you were state champion at one point.
Thanks.
Are there any other players in this area who have received, you know, national attention for the game?
We have right now a kid who plays often at the Chess Center named Jacob Chen, and he's nationally ranked. I remember when he came in the Chess Center, and he started when he was in kindergarten, but he always just, like, he sat on the board, he'd be running around, and then when he sat down the board, he would just focus on the game and just clicked. And I think he's right now in the top, like, 30 in the nation, which is amazing. He's quite good.
Well, chess clubs, they seem to be increasingly popular in schools. My two stepsons play chess, Luke and Trevor, and they both recently won trophies. They beat out all the other kids in their class. And they tell me, the kids at the Chess Center said the same thing, that it can help them with school. And do you think there's a case for that? Do you see that there are educational benefits to playing the game?
Of course, we see it, but the way I tell schools, there's no better complement to the education process than the game of chess. And and those schools that run chess clubs, they find out that there's kids who are not that well doing that well at school, but once they start taking up chess, they want to come to school. They want to play the chess, and
yeah.
it invigorates them for the scholastic process.
What about you, James? Did it have any impact on your schoolwork? You've been doing it. You did it all throughout your elementary, middle, high school years.
Yeah. You know, my mom this morning, we were talking about, like, how long I played chess. And she's noticed that. She's like, you became such a good person. This is my mom. She's a little bit biased. And she really thinks chess was a great way for me to learn before at a young age the learning is an amazing thing. And when you got, when I kept learning more and more chess strategy, my brain felt like got like better at spatial reasoning, better at like plan making, and just like better decision making. And that's something that you can apply with anything you learn at school or at studies later in your life.
Oh, I have to ask one question. Where are the girls? I was at the Rochester Chess Center, even at my stepson's school. I mean, obviously I saw girls playing the game at their tournament, but they were definitely outnumbered by boys. Mm-hmm. Why is it that we don't hear about young women really taking on this game?
I knew she was going to ask that question, and I don't have a good answer for that. In our younger programs, we have 20 or 30% girls. When they get to be teenagers, we lose every single one of them. In fact, we had a program with a half a dozen Brighton girls that were coming, and when they got 12 or 13, I said, gosh, we finally got it. We've got the critical mass now. These girls will keep together now and continue on, and one by one, one moved away, and one decided to focus on the music, and then eventually we lost every one again. But there are good women chess players. In fact, we were talking before we came on camera.
Yep.
Judith Polgar is number in the top 10 in the world.
Against men.
Against men also, yes.
Yeah. All right, well, I want to say thank you both for being here. Area chess instructor and SUNY Geneseo student, James Hiltunen, and Ron Lorman, owner of the Rochester Chess Center. Thanks for talking with me today. To learn more about area chess camps, leagues, classes, check out the Rochester Chess Center's website, nychess.org. And that is it for this edition of Need to Know Rochester. I'm Helene Bian-Duty Hofer. Thank you for joining us, and thank you for supporting news and public affairs programming on WXXI. We'll see you at our new day and time Thursday nights at 8 o'clock right here on WXXI-TV.